that, so you know what it's about, in a passage from the start of it and then a passage further in. Simon isn't real. She's a terrifying computer game character who erodes player sanities. Just because her legend dates back to the 1600s doesn't mean she's real. Just because people are vanishing doesn't mean she's real. Just because she's standing in the corner, reality is an illusion. Drake Skelton, Ben Crewe and Kiva Black, the 17-year-old outcasts. The obsession of Simon doing silence seems normal. Until game features creep into their town. Missing person's posters, deep-based patient records, the mutilated Victorian patient who hangs herself in the woods. The madness infects you. As more people play the game, the veil between the reality and theirs is torn down until they can no longer trust their own minds. But this is real life. Computer game characters don't kidnap teenagers or poison their minds to decide on some of suicide. Yet there's something, the flash of a red dress in the corners of their eyes, the shadow that creeps across their walls at night, the sinister humming that warns them they're not really alone. She's coming. Silent Dawn is waiting to tell. Black trees imprisoned Drake, their bare, gnarled branches, elongated limbs of the undead, poised to steer him away to the underworld. Every snapping twig was death's bony feet clicking in his wake. Leaves rained, fiery tears of defeated gods, their bodies decaying where they fell. Nine creatures sang a chorus warning of inevitable pain. Ominous drums beat in his heart's frantic rhythm. Fog caressed him like the dying breath of a thousand tortured spirits. Drake turned, his torch beam dancing around him. Rusting chain link fencing caged him on one side. Brambles clawed through the links, their thorny tendrils longing to rip his flesh and taste his blood. The woods beckoned him to their sinister lair, enticing him with dark promises that would ultimately destroy him. He turned his back on the trees, keeping the fence to his right, praying the only footsteps secured on his own. A sheet of paper was pinned to a tree's body, a white target for the firing squad. Missing, Connor Williams. Child's grainy image stared from the page. His soulless eyes were black hollows, watching Drake from beyond the grave. Yet the other side of death contained not salvation, but suffering. Twigs crunched. Drake's heart pulsed dread through his body, counting down to doom. He killed his torchlight, reluctant to see what skulked beneath the trees. Darkness lured the shadows, humming the stony silence. Drake moved on, fighting the urge to run. She cured him, feeding off his panicked heartbeats until they faded into death. Crooked black gates, buried alive by ivy, awaited him in the clearing. 10-foot high walls flanked them, topped by rusted barbed wire. Ivy seeped over the top and down the walls as though it died trying to escape. Peeling wrought iron formed curved words at the lower top of the gates. Nightshade of silence. They stood ajar, tempting him into their lair. Drake stopped. An irrational fear warned him if he crossed the threshold, he might never return. He squeezed through the gates, his footsteps crumbling in an efficient drive. The gates banged shut. Drake whirled around, Ivy sealed and closed. An ambulance floated outside the asylum, its rusting skeleton shedding its painted skin. Drake circled it. Cold sweat shrouded him as he approached the open back door. He hesitated and peered inside. Blood stained the stretch on the floor. Fingernail gouges on the floor betrayed someone's fate. Drake backed away and faced the asylum, crumbling under the weight of its own misery. Reeds grew from his fractured steps as though escaping a living hell. Drake kept up the steps and tore down a blood-stained patient's record taped to the door. Blood dripped on the word. Run. A fading sepia photograph was painted to the record. A skeletal man with an empty stare. Patient, John Jacobs. Reason for admittance, hysteria. The door creaked open. Drake's torch exposed flaking paint in an abandoned trolley bed. The smell of damp and trapped dust greeted him. Apprehension tingled through him. He edged inside, treading carefully on the debris strewn floor. The beauty stained the walls. She's coming. In the desolate corridor, figure in darkness whispered the fearless secrets. Distant weeping echoed through the corridor. Help me, scratched into a door. He pushed it open, revealing rows of empty beds. Mummy infiltrated his brain. He pivoted. He collided with a mutilated woman. Drake yelled and fell on his chair. It shot backwards into his bookcase, sending a Jack Skeleton figurine tumbling to its death. Drake rested his head on the floor, waiting for his heart to stop trying to tear free from his chest. His skull-like lightshade swung, and Lucy's shadow stained in the wall like Poe's deadly pendulum. He blinked, and it vanished. He staggered up, averting his gaze from the monitor. Dropping in his chair, he scooted it forwards. Static fizzed on the screen, distorting the desire. Shadows and black veins crawled beneath the wound skin, which was the colour of ancient gravestones. Jagged raven hair, covered in a veil of broken spider web, swept across her once beautiful face. Black sockets wet blood on her eyes used to dream. Her stitched lips smiled. Drake's flashy character lay strapped to a table, stitches weaving through his lips. Laughter echoed through the corridors. Silent dawn takes shape. So the next passage is from slightly later in the book, where Silent Dawn has got hold of this and is a little bit more. Ben switched his computer on. You'd better lay out your nice china, Silent Dawn, because I'm coming for a visit. He flicked through his research and the game loaded. You'd better enjoy playing it while he was free. All he took for entertainment in a hospital would be counselling sessions and puppet making class. Did they see the humour if he made the Silent Dawn puppet? Even if his stitching was perfect, he clicked, let the hunt begin. Silent Dawn was waiting. It's time the hunted became the hunter. Rusted, keep out, no trespassing, signs. Clung to the chain link fencing. Blood stained the corner of one. A coiled chain of corroded padlock being partially buried in the dirt. Ben's character squeezed through the gap and switched on his torch. Beams swept through the trees, shadows parted like theatre curtains on opening night. He ventured off the path. Squeak. He stopped. Squeak. He turned, his light falling on a corroded gibbet cage hanging from a tree. The record was pinned to the bars. She's inside you. Well, that's disturbing. You can't be in there, Silent Dawn. He glanced down and prodded his stomach. Can I get you anything? Drinks? Hot beverage? Patient, William Layton. Reason for admittance, self-mutilation. A scarred man stared numbly from his photo. The gibbet swung as Ben collected the record, the chain squealing as though in pain. As he moved away, the cage door squeaked open. He turned around. A decomposing corpse was imprisoned inside, wearing peeps and trousers and a hose top. Ben turned away, her knees festering inside him. He trampled the dying bluebells, ducking beneath branches, and stopped outside the small hut. That's new. Maybe there's been an update. I really hope that's not the toilet. Frankly, Dawn, that would kill some of my fear. The hut door creaked open. Ivy crawled in from outside and slithered up the walls. Newspaper clippings, drawings of Silent Dawn, and Drake's photos plastered the wall. Red marker pen was scrawled over them. Reality is in the air. The monsters are inside us. Screams and the music. That's the contents of my file. Ben took a screenshot and videoed the screen and checked his bag. The file and its contents were still in there. Heaven tormented him. His torchlight faded. He backed out of the hut. Silent Dawn stood 10 feet away, her scarlet dress hugging her body, trailing on the ground around her like a spreading bloodstain. The scream whizzed, the humming grew louder. He ran. Labored breathing seeped through the speakers. Children's voices cried out, help us, she's coming. He ran through the gates and went to the asylum. The door edged open, a record pinned to the other door. Welcome back, then. He clicked on it. Patient, bending through. Reason for admittance. Delusions. Sweat shrouded him. His heart thumped, the blood rushing around his ears. His hand shook. He took a photo on his phone. No, you can't have me, Dawn. You can take my sanity, but I will never be yours. Ben switched his torch back on and surveyed the gloomy corridor. He crept forward, the spears appearing like jagged teeth leading to the monster's mouth. I've seen you. Ben jumped. It sounded like she'd whispered in his ear. He glanced around. Darkness cloaked his room. He got up and flicked the light switch. Nothing. Mum, there's been a power... No. There was a power cut. My computer wouldn't work. Maybe the light's fuse is blown. He opened the door. Mum, the light's out. The landlord glowed. His keyboards. Ben closed the door. Maybe it's just my bulb glow. That's a rational explanation. I could be rational. Just because it's only in my room doesn't mean she's responsible. Multiple all the time. He knelt by his bed, pulled the box out and groped inside it with his torch. He clicked it on. Broken tiles littered the floor. The beam panned up, exposing peeling paint on the walls. Combing a seep from his skin. Damp permeated the room like a body of silent perfume moves out busily. Black graffiti stained one wall. The monsters are inside us. The beam slunk over shackles dangling from the wall. Silent dawn stood in the corner.